Keith. How's it going today?
It's going great, Jay.
So you and I have known each other a long time now.
Yes, wow. Really long time.
Yeah, thanks, Keith. So I appreciate you coming out to Industry Giants.
Well, I appreciate you asking me to come out.
Thank you very much. So I want to dig right in. Right? Because there's a lot of things going on in this sphere. People are coming to this conference to get good information. And what I think is so compelling about you is, you know, DNA, the company you started, was a little tiny company.
Yes,
and
two
it was,
people.
Yeah, it was just you and John really trying to make a go at it.
Right.
Would you mind kind of starting off kind of where you started and how you kind of wound up to where you are now?
Well, yes, I'll be happy to. It's this. You got a picture, 1987.
Okay.
No internet. If you want to reach out to, the world was much larger back then because there was no internet. And so if we wanted to do some marketing, for instance, like, hey, let's reach out to this area, we would go to the library and look in the phone books under that particular area, write down everything. Because remember, I mean, even computers back then were, if you could get them, they were outrageous. So the world was a different place. I'm really surprised that we made it this far without cell phones and iPads and everything else. But so that's how we started. It took us 3 years to add one employee. It was the hardest thing I ever did because then I'm responsible for one person. So, you know, fast forward about 13 years, we have 150 employees. And then fast forward another 2 years, and we have 250 employees. And it became so overwhelming. It was kind of like falling into the Grand Canyon. And there's a point where I'm sure, I've never done it, but I'm sure that if, while you're falling, after you get past the fear, you just kind of go, ah, oh well. And that's kind of the way it was when you have 250 employees. You just, you don't know. You know, it's so overwhelming that you just go, well, we'll just get our work done and everything will be great. And then, you know, you fast forward a few years, you build something that large. You've got to keep feeding it. You know, it's just like having a pet elephant. You have to keep feeding it and feed it and feed it. And then you notice one day, hey, we're running really low on peanuts. And then we're out of peanuts, and you know, it's either you got to give the elephant away or it's going to eat you. And so in our case, it kind of did both. It ate us and, you know, but it was a great experience. I wouldn't trade it for anything. Even sitting up in the office by myself, 28,000 square feet, no one there, it's still, the whole thing was a great experience. And it kind of, the reason it was is because I feel like, especially toward the end, I felt like we were doing something of some substance, something that meant something to somebody. And one of my, you know, sort of my mantra that I just made up today, no, my mantra that I go by is, you know, more than being successful financially, add value to the world around you. And I'm not just saying this because Jay's right here, but I don't even know which camera is getting what, but Jay, even at my advanced age, taught me that something that resonated with me, and I fought it for a long time, that make sure, because everything we do in this industry lives well beyond us. And as people, we grow and develop. And sometimes we may end up regretting something we have made or done, or, you know, whatever, written, animated. And it's not the same as, hey, I went out and I got drunk and I went home and fell asleep in the bathroom. That's you know, you get over that. No one will necessarily always remember that, but they will remember things that you do in this field because it lives forever. And Jay told me that, and I was like, ah, Jay, just quit being so tall. And so I then one day it hit me that, oh my gosh, he was right. And I just, you know, I was in the process of flipping it over anyway, but that kept coming back to me. And I did call you. Yeah, I did. You have to.
Yeah, you did. He called me up, and how it worked was Keith calls me and he goes, man, I got to apologize to you. And I said, what? What? Keith's never done anything to me in my life. And then you said, hey, what you had, and it had been like 3 years, man.
Yeah.
I mean, before we had that conversation.
Yeah. And yeah. It just kind of stuck with me, and it really got to me, because at first I was kind of irritated at you, like, what does he know? You know,
it's not unusual, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah. Trust me, I've heard. No, I'm kidding. But the more I started, you know, thinking about, you know, you think about things like legacies and what do you want to leave behind and things like that. And I went, oh no. I mean, it hit me right in the face. Mm-hmm. I just went, oh no, it is important what you leave behind. And so that's when I got on the phone and like, oh man, it kind of helped. It was my one step program. Just call Jay and, you know, and then, you know, ask God to forgive me and then everything's okay.
Well, it's lessons learned. I mean,
it's a great lesson learned. And it's something that I even talked to my daughter, who's an artist, and she wants to be an animator. It's like, do stuff you're going to be proud of. You know, I mean, we can't do, I mean, every commercial we ever do or every project we do, we're not like, oh gosh, this is making a difference in the world. But that should be our ultimate goal, is mm-hmm. to do things that we feel like are making a difference with people.
Right. I mean, I think doing something of importance mm-hmm. is really what gets you up in the morning
yeah.
and helps you do it. And speaking of that, that's a good transition to where you are now, right? Because what are you doing now?
Well, I'm working, one of the projects I'm working on is a project called Allegories, but it's spelled O-W-L. Agoris.
Gotcha.
And it's animated series that basically teaches about the awesomeness of God and you know, that all seen through nature. You know, you mm-hmm. can see the sun and the, you know, the water and everything that he's done, that he's created. And it's a way just to help children build a foundation with God, if that's what they choose to do.
That's right. And so it's, you know, even taking a stance like that,
mm-hmm.
right? Then some people say, oh, Keith has found religion. You know, Keith.
Well, no, actually, I have always been a Christian.
Right.
But I wasn't always putting my money where my mouth was. And I decided, you know, I kept wrestling with what you said. It's weird that one thing stuck with me for so long, and because I knew you were right.
Oh, wow.
And that's why I kept wrestling with it, because I kept trying to debate it and I never could. But anyway, I'm working on that, and then I'm working on a top secret project.
Oh, cool.
That I wish I could talk about.
But right.
But I can't right now.
The lawyers.
Yes.
Well, talk a little, real quick, I want to transition, because that's mm-hmm. really interesting how you... you know, you had a small company, you bloomed to this huge mm-hmm. company, and then now you're kind of back in startup mode.
Right. Well, I'm working with a small studio called Out of Order Studios that's in the Stockyards, Fort
okay.
Worth.
Cool.
We work in the basement, and it's great. I'm getting to work with a lot of DNA folks again.
Nice.
And so it's awesome. It's almost like, you know, bringing all the, because I love working with people. Mm-hmm. As, you know, I've worked by myself at home, and, you know, it's like, oh, it's kind of nice because you don't have to fight traffic and you don't, you know, have all the office politics. But there's actually none in the studio. It's owned by a couple of really good guys that I've known for a long time. And we're working on this top secret project. But it's just great. I mean, it's no egos, no politics at all in the office. Everybody's friends and gets along, and we have a great time every day.
And you know how special that is, because that's not the way it is.
That's not the norm.
That is not the norm.
No.
Right? And so you and I were talking a little bit earlier. We were talking about collaboration and important skill sets that people should know. A lot of people focus on the tools and the technology, and they think that's what's all important, is I just need to be really proficient and really good. And that's part of it, right?
That is a big part of it. But you also need the soft skills that we talked about, the social skills, the ability to work with others. Because some people can't have a hard time with that. I mean, a really, really hard time. And it will end up being your downfall, I promise you, if you can't learn to work with others. Because everything in business is collaboration. You're either working with a client, or you're working with a producer, or you're working with somebody, a director. And you need to be able to work with them and talk with them and express yourself in a professional manner, and also, you know, play. That's not just working with them, but work well with them. You know, play nice in the sandbox, because people like to work with people they like. And it's really that simple. You know, if you're difficult to work with, or you're standoffish, I mean, a lot of times that can cost you work. And people may not see your true abilities, because they're sort of off-put by somebody. They feel like either, well, they don't talk to me, they don't like me, or they don't talk to me, I don't know if they're having trouble, and they will, because they won't come to me. I mean, there's a lot of things like that that, you know, you need to be able to talk and have and communicate with people. And you know, it's kind of an art that I notice it as I'm growing older and older and older.
I was out in the library or the bookstore, and I saw there's a book on managing millennials, right? And your daughter now, she's an adult, right? And so she's out there, and so I'm sure you're having conversations with her. Does she come to you for advice?
Yeah, she does. Every time she will occasionally work with clients, and she'll send them correspondence, and she'll read it to me. How does this sound? And things like that. And she's great. I mean, she's really sounds professional. She, you know, she's never rude. She's always acting like, even though I know sometimes, you know, clients can be aggravating at times, she never lets that on. She always makes it sound like she's doing things in their best interest. Here are your options, things like that, that we all need to be able to do so that clients feel respected. And that's all anybody wants, really. At the end of the day, all of us want to be respected, but that's how simple it is. It's just show people the respect you would like to have.
And I like what you said there, because, you know, to me, you've been a mentor to me. And it's so nice to hear that in some small way, you know, I contributed at least to thinking about something differently.
No, actually, it was a huge way. And if anything, you've mentored me, which is weird because you're younger, and I should be the one mentoring you. But, I mean, that resonated with me so strongly, and I fought it for so long that whenever I did relent and just say, you know what, I hate to admit this because I know Jay... And I really thought I would get a lot more I told you so's and stuff like that, but he was very gracious about it. And
it's interesting, and this would be a testimonial for me. A lot of people will say that I'm always trying to be right, and that's not where my heart is coming from.
No, you're not.
My heart is coming from being helpful.
Yeah,
and
I mean, that's all you were trying to do with anybody. I mean, with me, even. And it's that. You're like, oh, do you really want to be known for that? And then it's like, oh, no, I really don't. And I know a lot of people know me for early stuff.
Right.
And it's like, and it's I have to correct them immediately. Like, well, I don't do that.
Right,
anymore. Anymore, no.
So let's finish up. I want to talk about mentorship. Who were some of the mentors for you early on? Right? And then now you're having an opportunity to mentor other people. So talk a little bit about what you learned from some of your mentors and how you try to mentor people now from some of the lessons you learned.
Well, when I started in the business, I had several people. I was very fortunate to work with some really nice, helpful people. I started out at a company called K&H Productions, which probably, if you've heard of them, you and I are maybe the only people in the room that have heard of them. But it was run by Rod Kites and Tom Young, two amazing professionals that taught me a lot about being a professional, how to work with others. And I would see, you know, this was back in the old days when we, you know, inked and painted cells and went through that whole, you know, crazy thing. It wasn't digital click fill stuff. And, you know, I would see them working and just, and see them interacting with clients. And, you know, I was very fortunate to get to witness that. And even my partner, John, you know, I was, you know, I early on, you know, I would knee jerk things a little more than I should have. And he would always kind of sit back and let things play out a little bit more and not react. And I learned over the years that, you know, I just let things go for a minute, stop it before it gets too far, but let's see how far this goes. And if I take the high road, I can't be blamed for anything bad. So let me just see how this is going to play out, and let's try to keep it professional and, you know, work that way instead of, you know, getting in some kind of silly arguments or something. And, you know, I mean, you know, in a lot of ways, I went from K&H to a company that's now Post Asylum. I believe it's still Post Asylum, that was called Bill Stokes Associates. And I worked with Don Stokes and, you know, learned from him. I learned from Steve Barnes, who was at Bill Stokes at the time. Just a lot of people, you know, would impart wisdom on me. And instead of, you know, treating me like, you know, just a burden or something like that, because I didn't know everything that, you know, maybe I should have known, you know, when I went in for the job, they would work with me and teach me and teach me things about, you know, how the business works and how we should behave and things like that. And that's the thing that I like to try to impart on people I work with now, is that, you know, just be nice to people. That'll get you really far. If you know what you're doing and you're nice, that is a recipe for success.
Keith, I want to thank you again for coming.
Thank you.
And I appreciate you, sir.
You bet. I appreciate you too, buddy.